Welcome back, WNST, Towson, Baltimore, and Baltimore Positive. I keep changing my view of Baltimore's lovely Inner Harbor. Luke Jones will be down here soon enough on an often enough basis, eating the proverbial free hot dogs in the Camden Yards press box. He joins us now talking a little bit of Terps, a little bit of baseball. We're going to save the football for a little later on, especially with the big conversation of free agency. But I'd like to tell you that I've watched the Orioles play on spring training, and I know they were on some Major League Baseball network on Tuesday at a Bradenton or something. It hasn't found me, Luke, and I know for maybe a lot of other folks, it hasn't found them yet either. I know you've been a little bit more attached to this writing about not just the Ravens offseason, also the Terps and March Madness, and it hasn't felt very mad with no fans around, I must admit. But the baseball thing is the thing sort of hanging out there as the weather changes this week a little bit that I think, who are these guys? Who's going to pitch on opening day? How many games are they going to lose? Is it really 0.0? These are the deep probing questions that we're going to ask here on 60 Minutes today.
Yeah, that's what you're talking about when you're 3 years into a rebuilding process. That still has some a ways to go. I think you're seeing progress, but that doesn't mean that they're contending this year. Doesn't mean they're contending next year. But I think, and you just said it, so much of this, and I don't know if we need to belabor the point about Masson for another 25 minutes like we did last week.
No, I did that last week. I'm good with that. I'm good.
No, but the point still stands when you're not showing games.
But you have to start with that, to your point. You have to start with the fact that the people that run the place are insane. And, you know, God bless Jason Lock and Fora. Be well. Hope you're doing well. But, like, you know, I caught the wind of 2 hours of that, too. You know what I mean? Like, if you're really committed to fixing the thing, show up. Show up. Be here. Be present. Be in my life. Take the $3 a month that you're siphoning off my cable bill seriously and provide me with a product that doesn't make me want to take my Oriole jersey, which I did, and I admitted to Dennis. If I could turn the camera in this studio where my office is, I've been staring at my Orioles jersey that I got in 1994, 93, whatever it was. The white, you see me, I wear it at every game, right? Has Aparicio 11. It's a sort of 92, 93 style of Oriole jersey, so it's four jerseys ago at this point. And it still fits me, so I'm proud of that, 38 reg. I put it in a box. I put that Skipjacks, my Dundalk Jack, just the stuff I've been wearing. I just put it all in a box, and I'm like, you know what? If I go to an Oriole game this year, I'm going to wear something different. I'm not going to wear the thing I've always worn. But, like, I put my Oriole jersey in a box in March because I have no intention of wearing it this summer. Not for any spiteful thing, but just sort of like, when they're ready to recruit me, I'll be ready to go back. You know what I mean? Like, when someone wants me to come to the games, I'll start coming to the games again. And that's the problem they're going to have with everybody, I think.
Well, and when we get into the Masson thing, and then we'll get into talking about the team, and there are some interesting subplots to talk about, and it's been a fairly quiet spring to start, so that hasn't helped. Obviously, media coverage is different because of the pandemic. As much as we're seeing the light at the end of the tunnel, we're not there yet in that regard. But I think when you're not showing any games on your television network, and then in contrast, someone like me who lives in southern Pennsylvania, I've been able to watch an Orioles-Phillies game on NBC Sports Philadelphia. I've been able to watch an Orioles-Pirates game from Bradenton on AT&T Sportsnet Pittsburgh. It used to be Root Sports.
Luke, I've walked around the city. You know how RSNs are. Right? I walk eastbound toward Dundalk over my shoulder here, if you can look. And I walk down Eastern Avenue, and we've done this three or four times. Every day the weather gets above 50, I've been walking a lot. It's good for my back. It's good for my hips. It's good for my mojo. Makes my hair grow longer. And I stick my nose in places, like in Highland Town, see what's going on in places. Amici's. I stuck my nose in Amici's the other day. I stuck my nose in Taco Fiesta. I stuck my nose in Ekebon, you know, up and down Broadway, Cooper's. Thank you very much, Patrick, for letting me use the restroom. Every one of these places has a baseball game on. Like literally, when I walk into Amici's, the Cubs are on from Peoria playing the Rangers or whatever. I mean, there's baseball everywhere. Yeah, you go to Buffalo Wild Wings, wherever you go, there's baseball on. It's just not Oriole baseball. It's disgraceful. I mean, I can't get through it, and I can't talk about the players because I don't know anything about the players.
Right, and that was kind of the point I was trying to make. But let's take the Pirates, for example, who are at a very similar place as the Orioles right now. I mean, it's funny. I was texting a friend of mine. She's from Pittsburgh, and I kind of joked because the Orioles-Pirates game was on Pittsburgh's regional sports network on Sunday, so I had a chance to watch that. That's part of my Southern York County, Pennsylvania cable package that I have. And I said I didn't know if I could name more than one or two players on the Pirates, but here's the thing. They're going to be terrible, just like the Orioles are. They have 14 spring games on this spring. They did a segment with their catcher, Jacob Stallings, where they mic'd him up and he had an earpiece. And for three innings, the commentators had an off and on running conversation with him during the game. And I know we've seen some things like this in the All-Star game, and some people, purists hate it. But it's one of those things I embrace because that's a really unique look into a baseball player.
If you're a 9-year-old boy watching the game,
that's cool,
Sunday,
right? That's neat.
I can't imagine the 9-year-old boy in me having Dave Skaggs or Dave Duncan in 1977 do that, right?
Sure. So the point is, you have that kind of access, and look, is that individual segment, those three innings, going to sell a ton more tickets for the Pirates? Probably not. But if it leaves an impression in a large enough percentage of fans and young fans, as you mentioned, who think it's cool, wow, a major league catcher is talking to us during the game, that can pay some dividends down the road when the Pirates, hypothetically, like the Orioles, hopefully over the next couple of years, are better. So you see some things like that, and then you see Masson to this point not televising any games. There have been some reports. I know the Athletic reported late last week there could be a few games broadcasted later this month, but it's just a missed opportunity because on Sunday, you were able to watch Gunnar Henderson get an at-bat in the ninth inning against the Pirates. He's one of the Orioles' top young infield prospects. Now, he's 19 years old. He's not going to be in the major leagues for at least a couple more years, but I had a chance to lay my eyes on Gunnar Henderson and see that he's 6'3" and he swings from the left side. And
it's a G-U-N-N-A-R-E-R.
A-R, yeah, A-R. And yeah, the question is whether he's going to be a shortstop, stick it short, or whether he'll go to third base. He's 6'3", I think 195, 198, and still has some room to grow. He's an impressive kid, and I know he's
Cal
someone.
Cal Ripken was probably 6'3", 198 in 1981.
Yeah, somewhere like
probably
that.
Was. And
right, and So, I mean, whether he sticks it short, whether he goes to third base, I know he's someone that they like, that when they did their fall instructional camp in Sarasota last fall, he's someone that really kind of trended upward. He's someone that had a chance to work with, with the organization and, some of the limited opportunities for some of the minor leaguers, but he's someone they think has a very legitimate major league bat, but he's a couple years away. Point is, when Masson shows a handful of games, you get a glimpse at him. You get to see Adley Rutschman, who DH'd on Saturday night in a game that wasn't televised. So,
and by the way, you're not going to see in April or May or June.
Yeah, I mean, you might see him later. Right, you might see him later in the season. He's probably going to start at Double-A Bowie. We know the minor league season is starting a little bit later. That's not unexpected, but again, that's still on skates. So long story short, you have a chance to see not just Trey Mancini, not just Anthony Santander, not just Dean Kramer and John Means and guys who've been at the major league level, but gives you a chance to see some of these young guys. I mean, all they're selling at this point is the future. Now, okay, maybe they're selling Trey Mancini's return. Look, that's a great thing. I don't want to be dismissive of that at all. But in terms of wins and losses, in terms of prosperity, it's all about the future. So to me, I mean, you're just doing yourself such a disservice in the long run by not offering fans a greater glimpse at some of these young guys. Yusniel Diaz, who I expect to be in Baltimore at some point this season, but he's going to start the year at Triple-A Norfolk. He's another example. He's hit a home run. He's had I believe it was a two-run double. These are guys that fans have heard a lot about, but they haven't necessarily seen a lot of, unless you're someone who goes to minor league games, and clearly that wasn't an option in 2020. So that's something that's frustrating, but that aside, overall, it's been a fairly quiet camp. Media access is different, and that's across the board, not just for Orioles, but across the 30 clubs. I mean, it's certainly different in that way in terms of no clubhouse access, so you're not getting that, that deeper insight. But overall, it's been a fairly uneventful start to camp for the Orioles. They haven't had a ton of injuries other than Alexander Wells, one of their pitching prospects who could see Baltimore at some point later this year, and Chris Davis, which, yeah, we're still doing that. So, but it hasn't been a camp that's necessarily
Chris
had
Davis
a lot
is gonna
of
be
big
on this
headlines.
Team April 1st in Boston and in the lineup or like that.
He I don't know if he's going to be in the lineup, but he the plan is at this point he's going to be
team.
On this roster. Yeah, and I think part of that, and we touched on this a little bit last year, Nestor, but if there's something that saved him being on the roster beyond just talking about ownership and the reluctance to move on and to eat the money, and we've talked about that for the better part of 3 years now, you do look at what happened with the pandemic. You had a 60-game season. They ended up not having to pay Chris Davis a large portion of what he was owed in 2020. So there's almost another – I don't want to say it's an incentive because that almost makes it sound like I condone what they're doing because it's obviously an embarrassing situation for all parties. It's pathetic. But he's going to be around at least for
they
the start of the year.
They do a lot of pathetic things, man. They really do. Like when it adds up, you can't get past the obvious. You know, it's like when people talk to me about Trump, I'm like, he told people to inject bleach. Like I can't get past the obvious, which is your games aren't on. You're stuck in this $100 million contract. You don't really have an owner. The owner's kid is here doing a 2-year kick the can on the they're the worst team in baseball. Like, I don't even know where to begin to tell people, come on back downtown and go to the game. Like, I, and again, they're a mystery to me, you know, from Greg Bader all the way and, you know, all the way down. Like, they're opening a season in 2.5 weeks and there's absolutely no inertia at all to let people know they're here. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. They even talk football on the flagship. Their flagship talks more about the Terps and about the Ravens and wants to. It boggles my mind. And then people say, hey, Nasty, why do you think they're trying to move? Well, it doesn't look like they're trying to stay. You know, I mean, it doesn't look like they're trying to, like, do anything or sell anything or be anything or bring the community together. It's mind-blowing to me all these years later. And then people wonder why I take my jersey down and put it in a box and talk about them like that. I don't even know what to say. You know, like, there's a lot of really tough questions. And I told Locke and Fora this, and he didn't want to hear it. I said there's a lot of really tough questions that need to be answered publicly for everyone in regard to them, because I talk to people every day, and not people like you that go down to the ballpark, the people that used to go that don't, like everybody in my life. It's not the first thing they do when they come home to Baltimore that they've got to go to a game. They got to get a crab cake. They got to see relatives. They got to see friends. They got to go to the place that they like the most. That used to be an Oriole game, and it really is slipping away, man. And I know during this plague and 60 games last year, this is a time where when the brand is damaged and they aren't very good, they need to try harder. And I don't really see that, dude. I don't see that. I live here in the city. I don't see it. I don't feel it in any way.
Well, it is tough because there are a lot of circumstances that all of baseball, all of professional sports are dealing with right now. But you're right. And as much as I do have confidence in what they're doing from a baseball standpoint, from a long-term vision standpoint in that realm, in terms of what they're doing with analytics and with technology, and you know, a player like Matt Harvey, who, look, I'm not at all excited about Matt Harvey potentially starting games for the Orioles in 2021, but I do think it is relevant when he does his introductory Zoom a couple weeks ago. He noted how his agent kind of gushed at the fact that the Orioles are a team that are absolutely embracing analytics and information and looking at technology and looking at things from a scientific standpoint in terms of pitch grips and release point and arm angle and things of that nature. So I like a lot of what Mike Elias and Sigma Dell are doing. I'm a believer in that part of it. It's everything else, like you mentioned. And let's be clear. The fact that we're not talking about wins and losses in 2021 is not remotely surprising, given where they were in 2018. Mike Elias did not lie to anyone when he arrived in November of 18 and said that this was going to be a long-term thing. When you go into a 2018 season hoping to be a wild card contender and you lose 115 games, you're talking about something that's completely scorched earth that's completely burnt, you know, just burnt down. They were done. They had no other choice but to do it this way. Now, we could certainly sit here and nitpick and say, okay, why'd you let Hanser Alberto go, who, by the way, got a minor league deal elsewhere? Why'd you let Ronaldo Nunez go, minor league deal elsewhere? Jonathan Villar let go last offseason. He's bounced around. So at the end of the day,
that was the Astros thing. If you go back to the Astros graveyard of, you know, giving it bats to Chris Davis is not part of the plan.
Sure.
They're piecing that in. And sort of F's up the whole plan to my way of thinking. You're either going to run the plan or you're going to run the plan with stipulations. And the stipulations are, let that guy hang out. I remember when I did that at the radio station, it didn't work out so good, you know?
Right. Do I think Chris Davis still being in this organization is damaging anything from a big picture standpoint, though? No, not really. I don't think he's going to play this year. Meaning, I don't think he's going to get any meaningful playing time. And he got hurt on the Grapefruit League opener. He's dealing with a bad back and hasn't played since then. I'm not going to sit here and question its legitimacy. Guys get hurt, especially guys in their mid-30s at this point. But it really lends itself again to, you're going to have a 26 – you're basically going to play with a 25-man roster because he's going to be on the roster or he's going to be on the IL, and maybe that's – ultimately, maybe that's going to be what he ends up – like last year, spent a large portion of the season on the injured list. And, you know, maybe we'll see that. In fact, it was funny, Nestor. I noted on Monday it was the 20th anniversary of the Orioles placing Albert Bell on the 60-day DL and saying that he was – or was, I guess, permanently disabled, whatever the terminology
was. I
was
at that spring training. Yeah. And, you know, Bell was complicit. He was hurt. The hip was bad. He was looking to get paid and get out. They were looking to pay him and get out.
Sure.
They made a deal, and they went away. And it was never heard from again, and Albert got his money, and apparently he's lived a decent life and played some decent golf as well. Sure, with some anger out in Tucson. but nonetheless, I don't think Chris Davis is going to play along, and they're not. I don't think they're in the same place, right? Like, obviously, we're 3.5 years into him batting a buck and a half and being the worst player in baseball, right? Like, not being a major league baseball player that they put a jersey on because the old man made a mistake.
Right, right. I mean, and again, I wasn't drawing that comparison suggesting that's what's going to happen. It's just the juxtaposition.
No, I'm suggesting it's not going to happen because it hasn't happened yet.
Right,
it was
exactly.
It's going to happen.
Well, and Albert Bell had a legitimate degenerative hip. Now, could he have tried to rehab that and
no, but that was about getting over on the insurance company. The insurance
sure,
company
exactly.
gave that money.
Right.
That's different than where we are with Chris Davis.
Yeah, they were on the hook for 2/5 of the remaining salary, whatever it ended up being. But, you know, I mean, it is what it is. Do I think it's causing irreparable damage to the rebuilding effort? No, I don't. Do I think it's embarrassing for all parties, him and the organization? Yeah. I mean, we're doing this song and dance and talking about it and not even playing now.
You can't tell people the place is being run the right way and put this forward. You cannot. It insults my intelligence.
Well, I don't yes and no, because I don't think Mike Elias is sitting there trying to fool anyone. I think he's basically, in enough terms, has kind of acknowledged, going into this, we knew that Chris Davis was – god awful the second half of 2017. We knew he was terrible in 2018. And when I signed up, you know, there was, you know, ownership wanted to see if a new regime, new eyeballs, new technology, new analytics, new coaching staff could try to get him back on track. Well, 2 years into that now, I think it's obvious and evident. No. So
hitting a baseball is really difficult.
But beyond that, I mean, that doesn't mean that it makes everything illegitimate from a baseball standpoint. That makes that business decision, ownership, certainly looking at that from a financial standpoint, big picture, yeah. But as far as what they're doing with their pitchers and what they're doing with their minor league hitters and the things that they are doing technology-wise, science-wise, I do believe in that. But yeah, this is a nuisance. So Chris Davis is going to be on the team, assuming he's healthy.
This isn't on Chris Davis. This is on them. Chris Davis has a contract. He's obligated to – and as much as, like, Dan Rogers, right, giving the money back, I'm like, give the money back to who? Putin? Right. I mean, come on, man. Give the money back. Like, what you do is you cut the player, admit the mistake, and pay the bill and honor the contract. But that's not the Angelos way. The Angelos way is if they could have Chris Davis fixing shower heads and folding laundry in the clubhouse, if they could get away with that in order for him to make his pay and put his 8 hours a day in and punch his card, they would have him do that. So that's where the embarrassment is. It's not that Chris
Davis. It's embarrassing for him too. I mean, let's be clear. And it hasn't exactly been a secret over the last couple of years that he hasn't necessarily been overly receptive to making adjustments. I mean, we all remember Jim Palmer talking about it with Scott, Scott Coolball, that conversation that was on a Wednesday afternoon game against the White Sox in Chicago, and Jim Palmer went on a rant. So you're right. Yeah, I mean, the organization, the ownership could make a very clear decision here to send him home, and you pay him and you move on, and it's a sunk cost. It's been a sunk cost for 2 years.
And you get at-bats at the same kid in Norfolk, and you don't get on every plane, every locker room, and all the kids in the room are like, what kind of place are they running with that guy? Like, what's he doing here? Like, he can't play. He makes $15 million. He lives in a, up on a hill somewhere. Like, what are we doing here? Like, I think it really, it's different than you think it is. I think when there's jobs at stake and guys want jobs and they're young and they just want to win and they're like, what? How can you tell me you're serious about winning when you're sanctioning this?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it matters that much in that regard. I'm not going to disagree with that sentiment. Do I think it's damaging any player? Do I think it's damaging their long term? I mean, okay. But I don't think anyone's looking at Mike Elias and saying he doesn't have credibility because of that. I think people, even young major league players, young minor league players, they understand the business side of this, and they understand, look, they like the fact that they have guaranteed contracts, unlike the NFL, where if Chris Davis had done this the last 3 years, he would have been unemployed 2 years ago. So, I mean, it is what it is.
Thomas.
Right. I mean, it is what it is in that regard. Again, it's definitely, I mean, it's embarrassing. It's embarrassing for him, too. I mean, this is a guy who used to be a 50-plus home run hitter, and he's been the worst player in Major League Baseball the last 3 years. When does it end? Does it end later this year? Does it end next offseason? I'm done predicting at this point. It's a joke. Even if Chris Davis had been playing over the last week and hit three home runs, it wouldn't have mattered. We saw him hit well last year. That didn't matter once they resumed the season in July. So it is what it is. There's plenty to like on the baseball side. But, yes, that is another example of when you look at the business side, when you look at all the non-baseball aspects of the organization, that they have a lot to prove. That's the nicest way to put it. They have a lot to prove over the next few years, even as you hope that they start to get back to winning more baseball games and becoming a more attractive product. To your point, they have not really done a whole lot of recruiting of people. And certainly during a pandemic, you can't do that in the way you normally would. But let's face it, even before the pandemic, talking about last winter, they had cut out Fan Fest. They were doing a caravan, which was, a stripped down version of the kind of off-season outreach that they'd done in the past. So there's a lot of work to do in that regard. And you hope that the clock's ticking, that you are getting to a point where this team's going to become more interesting at some point in, say, the next 12 to 18 months. We're going to see Adley Rutschman, if not the end of this year, certainly next year. We're going to see some more of these young pitchers come up. We're going to see a guy like Heston Kerstad, who they drafted second overall last year, is a college hitter. He's not going to take that terribly long in the minor league. So in the course of the next couple of years, this team should become much more interesting. Doesn't mean they're winning a World Series 2 years from now, but should be in a position where Fangraphs isn't saying they're 0.0% chance of making the postseason. But you want to be in a position where you can maximize that then. Once it gets a little more attractive, you want to be able to reach people, and that's not something you just roll out of bed when you say, oh, the rebuild's over, and then you open up the gates, and there aren't as many people there as there were even in, say, 2014, the last time this team was really in a position where you were talking about them as one of the absolute best in baseball.
Let me ask you this, because this was sort of the original question before we got into bitching about Masson and Chris Davis and the obvious warts of a team that's going to lose triple digits this summer and still trying to figure out how they're going to get anybody into the games. Who's on the field? Like, I literally, I'll go back and do the who's on first routine with you, and we'll do an Abbott Costello thing. But who's playing where? Like, who are the players this year? Because they've gotten rid of so many guys. I'm not sure. Somebody stopped me on the street and said, name the starting nine. I'd be very hard-pressed to do that.
And that's fair. I can understand, especially in the infield. I mean, of course, Hanser Alberto's gone. Renato Nunez, who had been more of a DH, but he's not back.
Two of the greatest names in Oriole history, by the way.
Right. But if you look at them on the field, you know, and then I'll get into the pitching, which is certainly more of a question, especially with the starting rotation. I think the bullpen, I feel pretty good about predicting at least 6-7 names that are going to be in the bullpen. But Severino is going to be the catcher to start the year. We know Adley Rutschman is ticketed to start at Bowie. He'll be at the alternate site until they start. I guess he'll probably stick in Florida and get ready that way, and then he'll go to Bowie. I would expect we'll see him in Norfolk, and then maybe in Baltimore before the year is out. Again, we'll see. I remind everyone, Adley Rutschman hasn't played a ton of minor league games. I mean, I think it's south of 30 minor league games that he's played. So, you know, give him a little bit of seasoning. I don't think he's going to need much.
Well, for all the guys in that class, that's going to be an issue last year, right? All that 20, 21, 22-year-old people that had a whole year taken away, crazy. Development.
Yeah, I think what's different is even someone like Adley Rutschman, who was at the alternate site. So he got some of that development by concentrate, as I've called it, where, you know, guys had, you know, they were playing sim games. They were getting a lot of extensive at bats. Pitchers were getting regular work facing live hitters. I mean, Adley Rutschman got to catch Grayson Rodriguez and DL Hall and Michael Bauman and some of the Orioles' best pitching prospects. So there was some value there. But where the bigger question was, were the minor leaguers who, not talking about filler, but guys that are, you know, at least a maybe, you know, maybe they're on the back end of the top 30 prospects. Maybe they're on the cusp, you know, someone that wasn't quite in that conversation, but, you know, was close to it. Those guys didn't necessarily get any work other than through Zoom and other than doing stuff on their own. So I think that's going to be a great question for not just the Orioles, but all of baseball. And maybe we don't really see the effects of that until next year, the year after that. You know, it'll be interesting to see where we are health-wise with pitchers. I think that's something that at the major league level and the minor league level. But getting back to your question, I mentioned Severino catching. Trey Mancini's going to be playing first base this year. He said that he has not worked out very much in the outfield, and that kind of makes sense when you look at the outfield, which is kind of the one area where you look at the Orioles and say, you know, they've got some talent there. You know, they've got some, you know, maybe not all of them are going to be around long-term, but at least a couple of those guys you look to and say long-term. Second base, and this is one you probably aren't familiar with, as you mentioned, Yolmer Sanchez is most likely going to be their starting second baseman. He's a former Gold Glover with the White Sox. Light hitting, but good defense kind of guy up the middle. You know, Alberto wasn't fantastic with the glove, so this is an upgrade defensively, which I think Mike Elias values a little more with where they are from a young pitching standpoint. But he's going to be the second baseman. Shortstop, Freddie Galvis was with the Phillies for a number of years, was with Cincinnati last year. You know, I mean, I'm not going to sit here and say that Freddie Galvis is a great shortstop. He's they traded Jose Iglesias, over the offseason, Freddie Galvis is going to be their shortstop. He's a guy who's been pretty durable, does have a little bit of pop. You know, he's solid defensively. Again, I think Elias is really trying to prioritize upgrading the infield defense because they need their young pitching staff to navigate 162 games. And if you're not making plays, you're not turning double plays, you're giving the opposition extra outs, those pitchers aren't going to survive in that scenario. So Freddie Galvis at shortstop, Rio Ruiz at third base, familiar with him, of course. There's been some talk. I know John Heyman has talked about potentially some interest in Michael Franco, another former Philly who, had a good year with the Royals last year. We'll see. I know some other teams are in on Franco, and clearly the Orioles are not in a position where they're interested in giving out much money at the major league level. I think that's evident at this point. But that brings us to the outfield where that's the one area from a position player standpoint that I think is exciting. Ryan Mountcastle is going to be in left field. We saw what he did last year. We know he's one of this team's top hitting prospects. And, last year, albeit in a smaller sample size, he played an okay left field, better than I thought he would, quite frankly, because his defense has been the big question for Mountcastle. Everyone knew the bat would play, but Now he's showed some good athleticism, and he played an okay left field. So we'll see him in left. Right field, Anthony Santander. You know, whether he gets dealt at some point between now and the trade deadline, we'll see. A lot of that, I think, is going to depend on what the offer is. A lot of that's going to depend on what Yusniel Diaz does at AAA. I do expect,
but that's part of how you play the game, right? I mean, that's where Elias is. Yeah. Man, we can steal two prospects on July 30th for him. Let's do it.
Right. And to be clear, Santander is only 26. I'm not saying that the Orioles should just be looking to deal him, but if he has a good year, but you also see Yusniel Diaz, who's raking at AAA, hypothetically, and someone wants to really likes Anthony Santander and wants to give you a couple legitimate prospects, so because you're talking about a 26-year-old guy who's, you know, still has a couple years of arbitration left, club control, and you feel Diaz is ready to come up to Baltimore and be your starting right fielder, well, there you go. You know, that's okay.
It's been 2.5 years since the Machado trade, dude.
Yeah. And Diaz has been hurt. You know, that was kind of, you know, he had hamstring and quad issues 2 years ago. There's some people in the organization I know that kind of feel he's the kind of guy that they almost want him to get to the major leagues because they think he's a spotlight kind of guy, that he kind of revels in that rather than riding the minor league buses. They kind of feel like he's got that big league mentality that he, you know, wants to be there, but he's got to prove himself a little bit more. And then, you know, center field, I think, is interesting because you have Cedric Mullins, who, of course, was touted as the heir apparent to Adam Jones a couple years back. Really, I mean, just had a nightmare 2019. You know, he was the opening day center fielder, and he was demoted all the way to Double A that year. But we saw him last year come back, bounce back, had a decent season, played great defense in center field. So he's in the mix. He's given up switch hitting. He's hitting only from the left side now, which I think was a good decision for him. He'd never hit from the right side, even go down to the lower levels of the minors. But a lefty facing a breaking ball from a left-handed pitcher at the major league level, it'll be interesting to see how he adjusts there. So
I remember you have him. You have experiment. I'm old enough for that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you have Cedric Mullins and Austin Hayes who are battling this out. And I think, you know, that we're going to see both those guys in the major leagues. And does it settle into a platoon situation? I mean, Hayes is the guy who's been touted for a few years now. You go back to that. What was it, 2017, had one of the best minor league seasons in all of pro baseball. And since then, he's struggled to stay healthy. He hasn't been consistent. We've seen it in flashes of 3 or 4 weeks at a time, him raking at the major league level. But we've seen a lot of him struggling, too. So those two guys, you're going to get good defense from either one of them. The question is going to be, offensively, what are you going to get? Is one of those guys going to seize the brass ring and become the, quote, center fielder of the future? We'll see. I still like Hayes for having a higher ceiling, but you know, Mullins played pretty well last year to kind of put himself back on the radar. So you have that, and then you come to DH, and you know, what does that look like exactly? I think you'll see Mountcastle there sometimes. I think you'll see Mancini there sometimes. If Chris Davis is on the roster, I think once a week, twice a week, maybe he's there. Depending on if DJ Stewart's on this club, I think that would be a great spot for him. You know, defensively, you don't trust him maybe as much as some of the other options I mentioned. So that's where you are. I think, and we saw this in 2020. I think you do have on any given night 4 or 5 guys out of your 9 that are in a lineup that are guys that you feel good about, guys that you feel can hit. And now you throw Mancini back into that mix. You know, that lineup looks more formidable. Now the bottom of the lineup, you know, you get down to Sanchez and Freddie Galvis and a couple guys like that. You know, who
brought
guys in,
you know,
catching that
night.
This
isn't the National League.
Yeah, yeah. So that's where you are with that. But, you know, I mean, the big question is going to be the pitching. You know, as I mentioned, I think the bullpen, Tanner Scott, Hunter Harvey, probably Cole Sulcer. Paul Fry had a good 2020. I think Sean Armstrong is a guy that you trust in middle relief. To me, Dylan Tate's kind of an X factor guy. He's got a really good arm. Really threw a much improved slider last year, but consistency is a question with him. So, you know, I just rattled off 5 or 6 guys there. You know, I think there's the makings of a bullpen that could be pretty interesting. You know, a bullpen that pitched really well last year, albeit a 60-game season. So how does that look over 162? A lot of that depends on what are you getting from your starters.
Well,
are you getting
– you want a good bullpen? Give me the bullpen that we don't go to until the 6th, 7th inning.
Exactly. I mean, look – you're seeing fewer and fewer starting pitchers pitch into the 7th inning anymore. I mean, the game has just changed
way,
in
right?
that way.
Totally.
Right, but you still need starters who are consistently at least getting to the fifth and the sixth and giving you competitive outings. You know, even if it's a case where a guy only pitches five innings, but does he give up five runs and you're down 5-1 going into the sixth inning, or is it a 3-2 ball game? And you know, they give you competitive innings. That's where the big question is. I mean, John Means is going to start on opening day. I think there's still a lot to like for him. His first couple outings in the spring haven't been great. I'm not concerned about that at this point. You know, he showed improved stuff from where he was the year before, even though, you know, his 2020 statistically didn't look all that impressive, but he's throwing harder. You know, he's someone who pitched really well in September, got himself back on track. I think, you know, we saw Dean Kramer and Keegan Aiken in September last year. Both of them had some really good outings. They missed bats. I think, sure, there's questions about them over a full season, just like any young pitcher. But those two guys, I think, have proven all they can prove down below. I think it's time for them to, you know, kind of start to see if they can sink or swim. And I think these are two guys that are at least interesting guys, guys that I think have a chance to not be number one, number two type starters at the major league level, but guys that I think can settle into the back half of a rotation. And you need that. I mean, you need those guys. So, but beyond those three, that's when you get into Felix Hernandez, Wade LeBlanc, Matt Harvey.
I've heard Jorge of all these Lopez. Guys. Hold on. I've heard of these guys.
Yeah. Oh, guys that used to be really good. You know, the question is, can they get enough out of these guys to give them some innings?
And I could sit here and you and I could be total a-holes and I could say Doug Drabeck and then you
sure.
could say Rick Sutcliffe and then Fernando Valenzuela and you could say, you know, we could, Kevin Millwood, we can go through all these names of guys that got here 5 years too late, not even 5 minutes yeah. too late, 5 years too late.
Yeah, I mean, Felix Hernandez, I mean, you're talking about a guy who I don't know if is a Hall of Famer. I think he's a guy that you at least talk about in that conversation, you know, but, you know, he's not throwing.
The Hall of nobody ever saw him pitch.
You know, he's a guy that's throwing in the high 80s now compared to where he was when he was King Felix at his prime and winning a Cy Young Award years ago. You know, can he adjust? I do know before he opted out for the pandemic-shortened portion of the season, you know, he was someone who made a pretty good impression in Atlanta last year. I mean, they said he was going to make their starting rotation to begin the season, but he's a different guy. You know, certainly he's not a guy that you're looking to be your number two, number three starter. So can he give them a couple good months and maybe they deal him? Can he give them a competitive season and be a leader, a leadership kind of guy for some of these young pitchers? Or is he going to be a guy, as you mentioned, and, you know, someone who comes to mind more recently, remember they added Dan Straley, what, very early in 2019, and he was gone after a short period of time because he couldn't do it. And now, you know, Dan Straley's gone to Korea and has had some success in the KBO from what I understand. So,
and eating good wings, I promise you, dog.
So those names that I mentioned, I'm not sitting here at all and telling you that I'm, quote, excited to see any of those guys pitch. But when you have three or four veteran options, when you have a really young rotation, you're coming off of a pandemic season that makes things so uncertain in terms of how you allocate innings, in terms of how you manage workloads, I think you are in a position where you need as many options as you can find. And if they can untap something in Felix Hernandez that he's able to get some outs, even though he's a different pitcher than he was 5-6 years ago, then great. You know, it's not as though they have so many young pitchers that are ready right now, but later this season, Michael Ballman could be ready. Zach Lowther could be ready. Alex Wells could be ready. Bruce Zimmerman, we saw for a cup of coffee. He's in the mix in that rotation. Albeit probably, you know, I'd say on the bottom of that list with some of these veteran guys that they probably want to at least take to Baltimore and see what they look like early in the season. So they have some other options, but guys who hadn't really pitched at the AAA level, the guys that were, you know, either at their alternate camp last year or kind of working on their own. So they have some guys that we could see later this year, but how do you bridge that gap? Elias has made it very clear with their young players, and I like this. This is a deviation from what we saw with Dan Duquette and what we saw even from Andy McPhail at times. Elias has made very clear he wants guys to kind of graduate from every level. I mean, that's kind of the way the Orioles did it 40 years ago.
Show me you're too good to play here, and then you
go back and look at Bobby Grich, who spent what 2 two, if not three, full seasons at AAA Rochester way
Rich
back
Dower
when.
Rich Dower won the Triple Crown, for crying out loud.
Yeah, Mike Boddicker pitching at AAA Rochester for a couple years before he could finally crack the rotation and was a 20-game winner soon thereafter. So I'm not saying you're going to have that. There's not that much of a logjam, but I think it's there's value. Mike Elias sees value in not just promoting someone from Bowie straight to the majors.
The way Duquette used to do that, like literally like, hey, yeah, because if you're any good, come on up. We'll see what you
right.
got.
I mean, we saw that kind of thing. And look, a lot of that had to do with, you know, they didn't have anyone else and they just threw someone into the fire and see if they were able to survive or not. But when you are talking about a team that's not trying to win at the major league level at this point, as far as being their primary objective, obviously that's where you do get in the position where, yeah, if it doesn't matter to what you're doing from a standings standpoint, wins and losses and playoff hopes and all those things, why would you call someone up from Double A when there's more for them to do down below, more for them to master?
Well, starting their clock as well, if they're ever any good.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's that. I mean, there's always that. But, you know, from a development standpoint, you know, they have some other young pitchers who my hope, if I'm looking at 2021, in a realistic best case scenario, doesn't mean they're in wild card contention or anything like that. My hope would be Dean Kramer and Keegan Aiken look like guys that are going to be in the rotation the next few years, at the very least. And I'm hoping we're seeing Zach Lowther make starts in July, August, and September. And we're seeing Michael Bauman make some starts at the end of the year. And maybe we're seeing Alex Wells make
some
starts.
You want to see a Malachi, Harness, Schilling sort of thing come together.
And you know what that means? If all those guys are up, then Felix Hernandez and Matt Harvey and Wade LeBlanc or whoever else you want to throw out there, either they didn't get the job done and they've been given their walking papers, or maybe Felix Hernandez pitched well for 6 weeks and they dealt him away for two 17-year-old Dominican prospects who are going to add to their system potentially down the road. I mean, you know, I'm not saying they're going to get much, but if you can have those guys give you some innings at the beginning of the year, buy some time for those young pitchers, and then you can trade them for some lottery tickets, and then you open up a spot in the rotation for a young guy. So that ideally is what I'd like to see in terms of a realistic best case scenario. And yeah, sure, let's see Adley Rutschman in August and September for a cup of coffee, and then you're going into 2022 knowing he's going to be your starting catcher, and he's going to be the face of this long, painful rebuild, but hopefully another sign that you're starting to see the light at the end of the tunnel.
My dude, Luke Jones, is all things baseball. Even though the Orioles aren't on the telly, he's watching with binoculars from Shrewsbury. You can find him at Baltimore Luke out on Twitter. Big thanks to all of our friends and all of our sponsors. All of our Wise Conversations, now presented by our friends at Wise Marks. We'll be telling you more about all that they do. I've been shopping at Wise a long time. Every time I shout out Rob Santoni's name, I get a text. So there. Shout out to Rob Santoni in Fullerton and all of our friends at Wise. You'll be hearing more about that. Also, our friends at Royal Farms. I got to get my my Bobby Nick box together here in the new world, but I have not promoted the world famous chicken here this week, although I did get some world famous gas the other day. It's not Royal Farms' price, problem that the prices are going up. It's the industry. But nonetheless, I digress. Still great gas, great chicken, and delicious Western fries. Once I get back off the beach, I'll get the Western fries and work my way into Easter shape around here. Luke is working his way into free agency shape as well for March 17th. A lot of Raven stuff out at Baltimore Positive, as well as getting you ready for the Terps. And I have to come up with a new name for March Madness, because it's not really – it's sort of March Madness light. It's not even really Madness light. I got to get rid of that. We're going to come up with a new word for Madness for what this is. Lightness, March Lightness. I don't know, but it's a tournament. And they're playing basketball, and some of us will gamble on it and watch. We are WNST.net, AM 1570, Towson, Baltimore, and we never stop talking. Baltimore Positive.